Well, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
A fine Sunday, but we'll probably be wet before the day is out. Just a guess. Just a guess.
50-50 chance.
I'd say 100% chance,
wow.
Personally.
Wow.
I was looking at the map, and all the stuff is moving up here, and Sarasota is right in the
path.
Right in the path. Anyway, we really need more rain. But, hey, pray for rain, and it worked. The Lord is good. Overflowing. Psalm 96. Giving glory to the Lord. And this has got a lot of familiar phrases in it. I'm reading from the ISV, so it won't be quite as poetic as the King James. Sometimes that has a better ring to it. Sing a new song to the Lord. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord. Bless his name. Proclaim his deliverance every day. Declare his glory among the nations, his awesome deed amongst the people. For the Lord is great and greatly to be praised, and he is awesome above all gods. For all the gods of the people are worthless idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and mighty are before him. Might and beauty are his sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and enter his courts. Worship the Lord in holy splendor. Tremble before him, all the earth. Declare among the nations that the Lord reigns. Indeed, he established the world so that it will not falter. He will judge people fairly. The heavens will be glad. The earth will rejoice. Even the sea and everything that fills it will roar. That's prophetic. That's prophetic. That's something that will happen. Okay? Not only do we get redeemed, all of creation gets redeemed. We have no concept of what that might mean, but I'm looking forward to it. The field and all that is in it will rejoice, and all the trees of the forest will sing for joy. They will be in the Lord's presence because he is coming. Indeed, he will come to judge the earth. He will judge the world fairly and its people reliably. So those are wonderful promises. I mean, it's something we really look forward to. And Psalm 96 can give you hope, okay? In the dark days when people seem to be making foolish judgments, it gives you hope. Let's be in prayer and say, thank you, Lord, because that's what prayer is all about. Coming before our Father who is in heaven and saying, thank you, Lord, because in spite of the craziness in the world, all is in your hands. And each of those among us who is ill and not feeling well, in the hospital, Lord, they're also in your hands. We trust that you will work your mighty deeds. You will work your pleasure. You will work for their good. And in the end, all will be rejoicing, praising you, regardless of the circumstances we find ourselves in today. And so we ask, Lord, that you be a blessing. The word that comes through Charlie, let it be a balm to our heart and a comfort to our soul. That we know that you are in charge. And Lord, some people say the Bible is a third prophecy. And I go, no, I think the Bible is all prophecy. For the Lord himself said, the scriptures are written of me, and they all point to me. And yes, they have other applications to our lives, but they all point to him, and that's all prophetic. So thank you, Lord, for your word. In our lives, let us take it to heart. Be with us this day. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to read from the Lord's Prayer, But not the Lord's Prayer that we know. That's the disciples' prayer. This is the true Lord's Prayer, and it's found in John 17. You see, Jesus said that we would be born again. And we'd be born of spirit. Not of flesh, but of spirit. And he told Nicodemus, you've got to be born again in order to come before the Lord. Otherwise, you're all tied to the world, and you'll perish with the world. But our days are numbered. Every one of us has a number, we just don't happen to know it. I've pointed out a couple of times, I have a gravestone. When I lost my wife, I said, hey, two for one, I'll just buy mine as well as hers. And so I have it there, and it's got 1942 written on it, dash, and then we're waiting to put that last number in. Lord knows that number. I don't. Does it matter? No, it doesn't matter. It will be his timing. And if it has a number, and this was very serious, if it has a number, that will be when I fulfill the purpose that the Lord had for my life. Oh, wait a minute. That would imply he has a purpose for everybody's life. Everybody has a purpose for their life. What did it take to fulfill that purpose? Well, at least you should look in the scriptures and see what they say to your heart, because I couldn't tell you. None of us can tell what somebody else's purpose is. It is a struggle and a blessing to find our own purpose okay, and fulfill it. And to me, that's exciting. And that's why I like the acronym for Bible, the I-B-L-E. Basic instructions before leaving Earth. And that's really the point. You got to get in there and read what it is you need to be doing, and everybody will find their own purpose. But when you get to the Lord's Prayer in John 17, he says some interesting things. He said, this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. And I have brought you glory on earth by completing the work you gave me to do. That can be generalized. Jesus felt that he had work to do, and he did it. He completed it to all of our benefit. But we have something to do as well. All right? And I believe it was, I'm not sure now who said it, but they said, there are two great moments in a person's life. The day you were born and the day you find out why. And that's our challenge. Find out why we were born. What is it that the Lord has for us on earth? Everybody is different. Everybody is different. Everybody has a different purpose. And Jesus goes on to say in John 17, verses 6, I have revealed to you those who you gave me out of the world. I have revealed to you those who you gave me. So his words, touching people's heart, allows us to be revealed to God as to who we are and what our purpose is. Now they know everything you have given me comes from you, for I gave them the words you gave me, and they accepted them. Very important. They know with certainty that I came from you, and they believed that you sent me. So I pray for them. I'm not praying for the world, but those whom you have given me. That's pretty serious. Jesus said, no, I'm not going to pray for everybody that a politician or has doing things to their own aggrandizement. No, I'm praying for the ones God has given me, and they have the purpose to be carried out, which gives us the wheat and the tares parable. Okay? There are tares in the world, and what does he say? You'll know them by their fruit. So we're not to be soul inspectors. We're to be fruit inspectors and figure out what it is. Now, this is most interesting. My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. In other words, hey, it's all done. We're ready. Everybody off to heaven. No. He's saying, no, not quite yet. That will happen soon enough. But you've got a purpose. You've got a reason. You're alive here in this world, which is, by the way, I'll tell you right now, it's a interesting construct that God has made. And I could give you a long physics dissertation on how we exist in a five-sense area, and that this isn't really real. It just happens to be the electrons of my hand are touching the electrons of this podium. Okay? But neither one of them is real because there's nothing there but empty space. It looks real to me. Feels real. And that's the point. God made us to exist in a special world with special constraints for the time being. Guess what? In the next world, those constraints will be removed. And we can't imagine what that's going to be like. So that's something to look forward to. But in the meantime, what are we supposed to be doing here and now? Well, he says, sanctify them with your truth, and your word is truth. Because as you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. As you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. Think about that. He has sent you. If you are a believer in Christ, have been born again, he has sent you into the world. And as he came into the world with a purpose, you are in the world with a purpose. Very important. Then he says, my prayer is not for them alone. Wait a minute, he just talked about the believers. Oh, wait a minute. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message. So he's already looking down the quarters of time and saying a whole lot of people are going to get born and are going to come to believe in me, and I'm praying for them here and now before I leave this mortal world. Wow. And the reason is that they may also be in us as we are in each other, as the world and the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them glory that you gave me, that may they may be as one as we are one. I and them, you and me, may they be brought complete in complete unity, and let the world know that you sent me and loved them as you have loved me. That's pretty incredible. God Almighty loves us as much as he loves Jesus. Yeah. Yeah, he really does. That gives us a future that is literally unimaginable. Couldn't begin to understand it. And so he ends up saying, Father, I want those whom you have given me to be with me where I am and see my glory that you have given me because you loved me and them before the creation of the world. Oh, we got a destiny that's incredible.
Can't wait.
And, yeah, Charlie said it. We can't wait. We're ready. But in the meantime, what do we do? We try to determine what God's purpose for us here on this earth is. And for each one of us, it's totally different. And you say, well, why do some die so young? That was their purpose. I don't know what it was, but that was their purpose. Why do some live on through ills and troubles and many, many years? because that was their purpose. And to fulfill it, they needed to live on many, many years. And so you always look at say, well, what is the Lord's purpose in my life? That's your challenge. That's your challenge.